All fantasy universes have a magic system of some kind, be it soft or hard. Some are very detailed, others are completely vague, but either way, a magic system often lends character to a fantasy world and helps to define it. Therefore, it makes sense that of all the great clans of Rokugan, I should start with the Phoenix Clan. Because while all the other great clans have their dedicated magic users, the Phoenix Clan is all about the magic. And their story, like that of all the other great clans, begins with the fall from heaven. When Hante, youngest of the 10 Kami and future emperor of Rokugan, cut open his father's stomach to free his siblings, one was already dead, one eventually landed in hell, while the other 7 fell to earth along with Hante himself. One of these 7 siblings was Shiba, the most curious and intellectual of his siblings, as well as twin brother to Byushi, future founder of the Scorpion Clan. Shiba is said to have been the first to notice that their 9th sibling, Fu Lang, was unaccounted for, and when the Kami went their separate ways to explore this new land they'd arrived in, Shiba, along with his sister Shinjo, spent a good chunk of their respective searches looking for their lost brother. Shiba never found Fu Lang, but it is said that he came across a place where the color itself had been drained from the ground and everything around him was blighted. This leads many to believe that Shiba had actually discovered the Festering Pit, the very site where Fu Lang had hit the ground, smashing through the mortal realm and ending up in Jigoku, the realm of hell. Shiba, of course, participated in the tournament that would determine who was going to be the ruler of Rokugan, and ultimately placed 4th, defeating his twin brother Byushi, only to subsequently lose to his sister Doji. Once Hante won the tournament and was acknowledged as the first emperor, he immediately began divvying up the lands of his new empire, and to Shiba he gave the heavily wooded country to the northeast. Shiba explored the lands of his new domain and, being a god, began attracting mortal followers the way a dog attracts fleas. Being a curious soul, Shiba spoke often with his newfound vassals, learning about their ways, their customs, their beliefs, and their concerns. After all, they were his new subjects now. He was their ruler, and he wanted to rule well. Then, one fateful day in the 25th year of the empire, Shiba wandered into the farthest northeasterly corner of his domain and discovered one man who was not willing to bend the knee, either to him or to his imperial brother. Many humans had witnessed the fall of the Kami to Earth, and one of these was a man named Isawa. All future generations aver that Isawa was the greatest magic user that had ever lived, and perhaps because of this great power, he was a prideful and stubborn man. Unlike the other mortals, he felt neither awe nor respect for the Kami. If anything, he was suspicious of them and resentful of their presumption to rule over the race of men. Humanity had gone without fallen gods before. It hadn't needed them then, and as far as Isawa was concerned, the people of Rokugan did not need these gods now. But however much he disliked them, Isawa was unwilling to actually go to war against the Kami who now presumed to rule over the new empire of Rokugan. Instead, he gathered to himself many other humans of like mind and journeyed to the far northeastern corner of the land, as far as they could go without ending up in the desert wastes of the far north. There, the newly made Tribe of Isawa, or Tribe of the Earth as they like to call themselves, erected by magic the city of Gisei Toshi, the rather ominously named City of Sacrifice. For a time, they lived in peace, independent of imperial rule, and free to continue the old customs and traditions of humanity before the fall of the Kami, namely the worship of the Fortunes, various minor gods and spirits that lived upon the earth and could be called upon at need. However, because Isawa and his immediate family were practitioners of magic, the tribe of Isawa mostly spent its time dedicated to the study of the ways of the Shugenja. A Shugenja is basically what happens when you take the mage class from D&D and combine it with the priest class. You see, the way that magic in Legend of the Five Rings works is that you cast spells by praying to the spirits. These prayers slash incantations are usually written out on pieces of paper called ofuda, and whether or not the spirits will actually respond to your spell depend on how well connected you are to the spirit in question. For each spirit or fortune has its own nature and personality. Before the Kami fell to Earth, most of the human tribes of Rokugan worshipped one or two fortunes each, spirits that were directly associated with them and their particular tribe. The tribe of Isawa, on the other hand, was unique in that they venerated all of the fortunes, especially the seven great fortunes. Benten, fortune of romantic love, Bishamon, the fortune of strength, Daikoku, the fortune of wealth, Ebisu, the fortune of honest work, Fukuro Kujin, fortune of wisdom and mercy, Hotei, fortune of contentment, and Jirojin, the fortune of longevity. The kind of spells that a Shugenja can cast are dependent on what kind of spirits they invoke, and these spirits can be roughly divided into five groups, each corresponding to one of the elements: fire, water, air, earth, and void. The nature of each element in turn determines what kind of spell you're casting. We'll start with air magic. In addition to letting you blow gusts of wind, air magic also allows you to induce sleep, cast illusions, and detect hidden things, both objects and the thoughts of others. Spells that boost reflexes and awareness also fall under the purview of air magic. Earth magic, meanwhile, allows you to manipulate rocks and minerals. Earth magic also includes any kind of spell used for warding or protection, as well as those that boost stamina and willpower. Fire magic, of course, allows you to shoot blasts of flame, bolts of lightning, and create light. But fire magic also includes spells that allow you to fly and boost agility and intelligence. Meanwhile, a user of water magic can manipulate anything from rain to ice to salt water to lake water. But water magic also includes healing spells, as well as spells that boost strength and perception, as well as the ability to see visions of the future. As for void magic, well, that's the tricky part. Void in Legend of the Five Rings is described as being all of the elements and simultaneously none of the elements. This means it is essentially impossible for me to describe void magic, except to say that it is the strongest and most dangerous of the five elements to draw upon. The best details I can provide is that some void spells give insane power boosts to their users, while others are used to negate the magics of the other elements. There was technically one other type of magic that the tribe of Isawa practiced, but that becomes relevant much later in the story. Regardless of what element you're using, when a Shugenja casts a spell, there are two things that he has to avoid at all costs. He must maintain his concentration while casting the spell, and he must ensure that the spell is properly formulated and performed. Sometimes if a spell goes wrong, nothing happens, but that's a rare best-case scenario kind of thing. Most of the time, a miscast spell will almost literally blow up in his face. Either the spirits he has summoned will be angered and lash out at him, or the backlash of the spell will drive him insane. Pretty risky, all things considered. Still, the tribe of Isawa applied themselves vigorously to the study of magic, believing that this mastery of magic would make them the equals of the Kami. That wasn't quite true, but it certainly gave Isawa and his followers a strong bargaining position when Shiba finally discovered them and the city of Gisei Toshi in the year 25. Fortunately for the tribe of Isawa, Shiba was a very accommodating individual, and both sides quickly hashed out a compromise. Isawa and his followers would nominally pledge their loyalty to Shiba, and by extension the Emperor Hante. In reality, though, Shiba would essentially leave Gisei Toshi and its inhabitants to their own devices, provided they did nothing that would bring them into conflict with the rest of the empire. Neither side was particularly happy with this deal, which in truth means it was probably a fair one. Isawa's pride chafed at the idea of even pretend obeisance, while Shiba, who truly believed that the rule of the Kami was best for all concerned, really did want to bring Isawa into the fold, but wasn't willing to force the issue. This means that while relations between the followers of Shiba and the followers of Isawa were both peaceful and prosperous, there was also a layer of friction and tension between the two, and Shiba simply knew that this could not work in the long term. He believed that what both parties needed was a sense of common purpose and shared identity, but he had no idea of how he was to achieve this. Shiba wrestled with this problem for some time, until finally the solution came to him in a dream. A phoenix appeared before the sleeping god and told him that it was a being of all of the elements in one form. With its flaming wings, the phoenix was obviously a creature of fire. It was also a creature of air because it could fly, but it also hatched from an egg and was thus of water as well. And that egg was born from the ashes of the phoenix when it died, and ashes are of the earth. It was all of the elements, and yet it was none of them, and thus it was also a creature of the void. The phoenix told Shiba, "You and I are not separate, but one in the same. I am the reflection of your soul, just as you are the manifestation of mine. We are death reborn, immortality through a thousand lifetimes. We are the cycle of the cosmos, spinning in patterns as old as time. We will die in flames only to rise again and again until the sky itself collapses. We are the phoenix, the eye of eternity." When he awoke the following morning, Shiba pronounced that from this day forward, he and all who followed him would be the Phoenix Clan, and that the sign of the phoenix would be the symbol of their unity and shared purpose. Isawa and his immediate family remained skeptical, but everyone else cheered this announcement, and soon even more humans flocked to Shiba's new banner. Among them was a young Shugenja student named Yogo and his wife, a healer named Asako. Asako was both gentle and intelligent, and her healing skills so impressed Shiba that he decided to grant her the right of founding her own samurai family, meaning that from this day forward, Asako and her descendants could count themselves among the leaders of the Phoenix Clan. Not to be outdone in displays of appreciation, Isawa and his family granted to Asako a parcel of land that included the Temple of Seido Jirojin, a shrine dedicated to Jirojin, Fortune of Longevity, and one of the oldest and most revered temples in all of Rokugan. Legend has it that after these honors were bestowed upon her, Asako journeyed for a month to find the right place to establish her family's seat. During that time, her sandals are said to have worn away to nothing, and before she finally found that perfect location, she was completely barefoot. From that day forward, the road to Kyuden Asako, the castle of the Asako family, has been known as the Barefoot Walk. Shiba spent the next several years split between his own lands and the imperial capital of Otosan Uchi. By now, the rest of his siblings had already married and produced children, and two of them, his sister Doji and brother Hida, were especially insistent that it was high time that Shiba finally got himself a wife. The only trouble was, neither of them could agree on what was the right type of woman for their bachelor brother. Doji, being something of a romantic, insisted that the ideal wife should be beautiful and talented, capable of making any man's heart skip with excitement. While the more pragmatic Hida insisted that the ideal wife ought to be strong and fertile, capable of bearing many children and standing beside her husband in battle. Fed up with their constant bickering, Shiba finally said that he would only agree to marry a woman who possessed all of the qualities that both his siblings had talked of. Evidently, the universe was listening to the leader of the Phoenix Clan, because sometime later, a beautiful young maid named Samaru came to the capital, begging for help. Samaru is described as being fairer than summer, but with fire in her eyes that spoke of hidden strength. In other words, she was exactly the kind of woman that Shiba had said he would marry, and the Kami of the Phoenix Clan lost his heart to her almost immediately. So, when Samaru said that her home and family were being threatened by a hideous monster, of course Shiba agreed to go and help her. What Samaru had neglected to mention to Shiba, until they reached her home, was that she wasn't human. Her home was under the ocean, and that was because she was a ningyo. A ningyo is basically the Japanese equivalent of a mermaid, but where the Western version is basically a beautiful lady with a fish tail, A Ningyo basically looks like the Naga from World of Warcraft, but with only one pair of arms. Evidently, though, the fact that his new girlfriend was quite literally fishy was not a deal breaker for Shiba. He helped destroy the sea monster that was threatening her home, presenting its teeth to Hante as a gift after the fact, and promptly asked Samaru to marry him. Although it would mean forever leaving her underwater home behind, Samaru agreed and became Shiba's wife, essentially assuming her human guise permanently. Soon enough, the happy couple welcomed the birth of Shiba's only son and heir, Shiba Tsuzaki. As a token of affection for her beloved husband, Samaru then forged for Shiba a magic katana named Ofushikai, which means mysterious according to the best translation that I could find. The katana itself is described as having a pearl-encrusted hilt and scabbard, and a glowing blade that looks as though water is constantly flowing down its length. At some undisclosed later date, Shiba received another martial gift, this time from his brother, the Kami Togashi, a suit of armor named Mezameru, or Awakening. Of course, the good times finally came to an end when the war with Fu Leng began in the year 33. Naturally, Shiba and his new made Phoenix clan instantly answered the summons of Emperor Hante to defend Rokugan against the demonic hordes of the Shadowlands. The clan's most significant contribution early in the war was the aforementioned husband and wife team of Yogo and Asako. By this point, Asako had trained many others in the healing arts, and they served as medics for the Imperial armies. Meanwhile, her husband Yogo, having trained in the magic arts under Isawa, served as a battle commander under Shiba. Their young son Saboten also wished to fight, but Shiba forbade his participation. Both his parents were already putting themselves at risk, Shiba was ultimately unwilling to risk sacrificing their only child as well. Naturally, Shiba asked Isawa for help in the war, but Isawa refused. To him, this was just a squabble between the gods that was no concern of his. It was only when a horde of demons made an incursion into Phoenix lands and destroyed the village of Toshi Tetsuharu that Isawa was finally convinced that this was not a conflict he could ignore. Isawa dispatched Shugenja of his tribe to fight alongside the samurai of the great clans during the war. And while Isawa and his blood relations refused to fight in the war themselves, they did extend to the great clans the offer to train anyone willing to learn the ways of the Shugenja. To this day, the Isawa family still likes to boast that all of the Shugenja families of Rokugan, like the Kuni, the Asahina, or the Agasha, are either descended directly from them or descended from students that were trained by Isawa during the war, making the Isawa the source of all the magical families in the Empire. As the demons of Fu Leng launched raids into the Empire, so the Empire retaliated by launching attacks into the Shadowlands themselves. In the 36th year of the Empire, the Shugenja Yogo, husband of Asako, launched such an attack upon the Shadowlands fortress known as the Castle of Murder. The fortress was heavily defended and laced with potent magical wards, but Yogo, a skilled practitioner of air magic, was able to bypass the magical defenses and pave the way for an Imperial victory. When Fu Leng received word of this, he immediately laid a curse upon Yogo, condemning him to one day betray those whom he loved most. A despairing Yogo was on the verge of committing seppuku when the Kami Bayushi persuaded him to instead defect to the Scorpion Clan as a way of protecting his wife and son from his curse. This decision was not well received by either Asako or Sagoten. Sagoten in particular never forgave his father for abandoning their family. Throughout the latter stages of the war, Isawa worked tirelessly to develop new kinds of magic to help his people against Fu Leng. And in the year 37 of the Empire, he and his most talented followers began work on arguably the most powerful magical creation ever made by mortal hands. Though creation might be stretching it a bit since Isawa never actually finished it. It was called Isawa's Last Wish. Isawa had always believed that the Kami had no more right to rule over men than anyone else, and he believed that the primary difference between men and the gods was merely perception. The Last Wish, essentially a living matrix of magic, had many functions, but its primary role was essentially to serve as a direct link of communication between the spirits and the mortal realm. Alas, despite his noble intentions, Isawa's Last Wish would mostly be remembered for its most infamous ability. In the wrong hands, or even the right hands, Isawa's Last Wish could use magical energy to literally remake reality itself. There really is no concrete description of what the Last Wish actually looked like, because whenever someone tried to use it, the Last Wish would change its form to best represent the intent and desires of the person trying to use it. It could be anything from a hammer and chisel, to a flower, to a burning sword. Given the insane amount of power required to make this thing, as well as the even more insane power it represented, Isawa insisted that work on The Last Wish be as slow and cautious as possible. As I said before, an improperly cast Shugenja spell can blow up in your face. A faulty reality-bending mechanism would be apocalyptically disastrous. But The Last Wish was intended to be more than just an interdimensional communicator and Rokugan's equivalent of the Infinity Gauntlet. It was also a wedding gift. Perhaps because he had been forced by circumstance to actively work alongside the Phoenix Clan, Isawa's attitude towards Shiba and his followers had softened somewhat, to the point where his daughter, Isawa Akiko, was to marry Asako Sagoten. Isawa himself was apparently fully on board with this union, and intended to present the Last Wish to the bride and groom as a present and as a symbol of the newfound unity and friendship between the Isawa and Asako families. But Isawa never got to finish the Last Wish, for in the year 42 of the Empire, the sage Shinsei came looking for a champion. As I mentioned in the previous Legend of the Five Rings video, Shiba was the one to personally record the conversations held between Emperor Hantei and Shinsei, and that these writings became the basis of Shinseiism, the primary religion slash philosophy of much of the empire. Of all the kami, Shiba was most impressed by Shinsei and quickly became the most devoted student of his teachings. When Shinsei had explained his need for seven champions to fight Fu Lang, Shiba had begged the sage to let him fight alongside them, but Shinsei had refused, insisting that only mortal men could confront the mad god. Shiba knew then that if the Phoenix Clan was to be represented by a mortal, he knew that there was only one who could possibly fit the job. And so he took Shinsei with him to Gisetoshi to speak with Isawa. By now, the tribe of Isawa had multiple holdings in the northeastern part of Phoenix lands. But Gisetoshi had always been their primary seat of power, and Isawa himself had forbidden anyone save a member of his own tribe from being allowed within its walls. But Shinsei had ways of going where he wasn't wanted, and was able to obtain entry along with Shiba. The first thing they saw was a funeral. A few days ago, a demonic raid had been launched against Gisetoshi, and several had died, including a younger sister of Isawa. The Shugenja and his family were all dressed in white robes of mourning, and stood gathered around the dead body. But this was no ordinary funeral. Remember how I said earlier that the tribe of Isawa practiced one other kind of magic in addition to the five elements? Well, this magic was Maho, blood magic, derived from the sixth element, corruption. As the horrified Shinsei watched, Isawa and his family members used a blood magic ritual to bind the soul of his dead sister into the walls of Gisetoshi so as to ensure its defenses. The souls of many of the Isawa dead were bound within the walls of the city, and would always emerge to defend it whenever the hordes of Fu Lang came calling. If you're familiar in any way with the Dragon Age games, then the blood magic in Legend of the Five Rings basically works along the same principles. The user sheds blood, his own or sometimes that of a victim, to fuel his magic, and that the use of blood magic inevitably corrupts the user and twists them into creatures of evil. Except Isawa and his people were not corrupted, and soon Shiba and Shinsei discovered why. The tribe of Isawa, as I'd said earlier, had honored all of the fortunes of Rokugan, not just one or two like the other tribes. The seven great fortunes were especially venerated, and it was they who protected the tribe of Isawa from the corrupting taint of blood magic, allowing them to use it freely without risk. Most of the kami had always been averse to the fortunes and their worship, suspecting them to be more malevolent than they pretended to be. This suspicion had not just been limited to the eight kami, but also extended to their parents, the Lord Moon and the Lady Sun. However, the revelation of the nature of the Isawa family's blood magic convinced Shiba of the innate benevolence of the fortunes. While Shinsei was arguing with Isawa over the use of blood magic and introduced the Shugenja to the ways of Shinseiism, Shiba communed with his mother and begged her to accept the fortunes into the pantheon in Tengoku, or heaven. The Lady Sun agreed, but only on the condition that the fortunes, particularly the seven fortunes, extend their blessings and protection to all those who served her children, not just the tribe of Isawa. The seven great fortunes agreed to this bargain, but in spreading themselves so thinly over so wide an area, their blessings and protections were not as strong as they had once been, and this would have repercussions for the future. But for the time being, Shinsei was successful in persuading Isawa and his followers to forswear any future use of blood magic and stick to the other five elements. Then, Shiba went to Isawa and asked him to accompany Shinsei in his quest to defeat Fu Lang. Yet again, Isawa refused. To Isawa, this was a war between gods that no one in Rokugan had asked for or wanted. He had lost many of his followers to this war, and now he had just lost one of his sisters. He was not about to leave the rest of his family undefended just so that he could go off and be Shiba's proxy. Besides, Shinsei himself had said that he needed one representative from each clan, but the tribe of Isawa had never joined the Phoenix Clan. Not really. Both Shiba and Isawa had agreed upon their first meeting that Isawa's loyalty would be only nominal, a show for the benefit of the rest of the empire. Accounts differ as to what exactly happened next. Some say that Isawa finally said that he would go with Shinsei, but only if Shiba asked him on his knees. Still other sources claim that Shiba knelt of his own volition, more than willing to sacrifice his pride for the salvation of the empire and his people. Either way, the god knelt before the mortal man and vowed that if Isawa would go with Shinsei to the Shadowlands, he, Shiba, would personally guarantee the safety of Isawa's kinsmen. Isawa was stunned. Whichever version you believe, he had never expected the proud god to actually abase himself in this way before him. And finally, perhaps for the first time, he fully recognized the inherent nobility and goodness of Shiba and agreed to be the Phoenix Thunder. Thus, the Isawa family became part of the Phoenix Clan in fact as well as in name. To this day, the kneeling of Shiba is considered one of the most heroic acts in the history of the Phoenix Clan, to the point where it's often used as a reprimand for stubborn children. Their parents will say to them, "Are you so tall that you cannot bend your knee as Shiba did?" Isawa may have finally pledged to help kill Fu Lang, but that's easier said than done. Unlike his siblings, Fu Lang was truly immortal, and his powers had only grown thanks to the corrupting influence of Jigoku. How do you kill a mad god? This was the question that ran through Isawa's mind. And before he went to join the other Thunders and Shinsei, he took with him from the great library of Gisei Toshi every scroll that he could carry that had anything to do with gods and souls and binding and destruction. The whole long journey south to the Shadowlands, every time that they stopped to rest or camp for the night, Isawa would spend long hours poring over the scrolls, trying to find a way to stop Fu Lang for good. In the end, he was forced to admit that there was no answer. Fu Lang was unkillable. Then, one of his companions, Otaku, the Kirin Clan Thunder, told him that they didn't need to kill Fu Lang, they only needed to stop him. And then, a candle lit in Isawa's mind, and he spent the rest of the journey formulating the spell that would save Rokugan from the mad god. Isawa had used magic to bind the souls of the dead into the walls of Gisei Toshi. What if he could do something similar with the essence of a god, bind it into some object, thus rendering Fulang harmless. But this spell would have to do more than just seal away Fulang's essence. It would need to fragment it, break it into pieces, sort of like how Horcruxes work in the Harry Potter series. And of course, as with any newly made spell, Isawa wasn't even certain that it would work, and the only way to find out was to face Fulang. And so, the day of thunder came. Shinsei and his 7 picked heroes infiltrated Fulang's chief fortress and cut their way through his retainers to strike down the mad god. During the battle, Isawa was mortally wounded by Mitsuhito, the first human to ever swear loyalty to the service of Fulang. Rather than use his magic to save himself, Isawa instead poured all of his strength into his untried and untested spell. And it worked. Fulang's essence was shattered into 12 pieces, and those fragments were sealed within 12 parchments that would become known as the Black Scrolls. By then, only Shinsei, Shosuro the Scorpion Thunder, and Hida Atarasi the Crab Thunder were left alive. With his dying breath, Isawa entrusted the Black Scrolls to them and warned that they must never be reopened or Fulang would return. Back in Rokugan, Shiba had begun to worry. Shinsei and the Thunders had been gone for some time, and there was no sign of their return. So he turned to the Isawa family for answers. Using water magic to scry for the sage and his followers, the Isawa family told Shiba that only 2 were left, and 1 was on the brink of death. Shiba was determined that Shinsei not die in the Shadowlands, and so promptly marched into those blighted wastes to save him. Eventually, he did find Shinsei along with a badly injured Shosuro, as well as a horde of demons pursuing them, led by a fearsome shape-shifting monstrosity known only as the First Oni, the first such monster ever created by Fulang. Armed with Ofu Shikai, the katana forged for him by his beloved wife, Shiba engaged the First Oni in mortal combat, and the fight only ended when each had dealt the other a mortal wound. Thanks to the magic of the sword, the first Oni's body was destroyed, and its spirit would never be able to manifest in the mortal realm again. From that day forward, the best it could do was spawn lesser demons called Netsumono and send them into the mortal realm instead. Shiba perished soon thereafter, having saved both Shinsei and Shosuro. As he died, he asked the sage how he could continue to protect his family if he was dead. Shinsei responded with the stereotypical, annoyingly cryptic response of an Eastern mystic. "Then find a way, Shiba." And Shiba did indeed find a way, by anchoring his soul to his sword. 1 year after the Day of Thunder, Shiba's son and heir, Shiba Tsuzaki, journeyed into the Shadowlands alone, claiming to have heard his father calling him. He found and recovered Ofu Shikai, and when he returned, men said that there was an aged sadness in his eyes. Tsuzaki, and by extension every single daimyo of the Shiba family ever since, has been able to commune directly with the spirit of their clan's founder. And from that day forward, the leader of the Shiba family, and by extension the Phoenix Clan champion, has been personally selected by the spirit of Shiba. Only those that he deemed worthy to lead the Shiba family could hold Ofu Shikai. Anyone else would find themselves unable to even hold the magic katana, as it would simply keep twisting out of their grips. After Tsuzaki returned from the Shadowlands with his father's sword and his father's soul, he sought out Asako, and the spirit of Shiba told her that in his dying conversation with Shinsei, Shiba believed that he had stumbled upon what he called the Path of Man. Shiba believed that it was mankind's destiny to one day transcend all the limitations that kept them small and weak and fallible, that they would one day essentially become gods themselves, like the Fortunes. However, this collective apotheosis of humanity would not occur for many centuries to come. Mankind as a whole was not yet ready to learn the Path of Man. Shiba wished to entrust the Asako family with the knowledge of the path. They were to learn it and safeguard its secrets until the time was right and man was ready to learn, and the Asako family would be their teachers. Asako, of course, accepted the task that Shiba gave her, memorizing all of the knowledge of the Path of Man that Shiba taught to her, and then writing it down in coded ciphers. Thus, the knowledge of the Path of Man has remained a secret known only to the Asako, and they have guarded that secret ever since. The Asako family are counted among the greatest healers in the Emerald Empire, and that is still their public face. But in secret, the Asako family are more like Buddhist monks, constantly studying and meditating upon the Path of Man, maintaining complete secrecy as they had promised Shiba so long ago. Unfortunately, this secrecy would come back to bite them down the road. With Isawa dead, the construction of the artifact known as Isawa's Last Wish was never completed, though Shugenja from both the Asako and Isawa families had worked tirelessly over the device for years. The Last Wish had intended to be a symbol of the newfound unity between the Isawa and Asako families, but instead, it would become the cause of bad blood between the two. After the Day of Thunder, and before the intended wedding of Asako's son, Sagoten, and the late Isawa's daughter, Akiko, one of Sagoten's cousins killed a member of the Isawa family in a dispute over the Last Wish. Despite the pleas of Sagoten, this death caused Akiko to call off the wedding. Relations between the two families deteriorated even further when the Isawa somehow discovered that the Asako were hiding something. They had no idea what the Path of Man was, but they knew that it was magical in nature, and they demanded that the Asako share their knowledge with them. Of course, Asako and her followers refused, keeping faith with the oath they had made to Shiba. This led to the Isawa family banishing all members of the Asako family from their lands, and especially from Gisei Toshi. By now, Hante was dead, and his son, Hante Genji, now ruled as emperor. Having been made aware of the Last Wish and of the two families feuding over it, Genji decreed that instead the Last Wish should be entrusted to the care of the Shiba family. This way, the Last Wish would remain with the Phoenix Clan, while also remaining firmly out of the hands of either side. Unfortunately, Asako Sagoten could still not get over being rejected by Akiko, and one fateful night in the year 72, he snuck into the castle of Shiro Akiko, where the Last Wish was being kept, and tried to use it to make Akiko love him again. Of course, it all went wrong, and Sagoten was killed by the Last Wish, along with Akiko and everyone within the city. To this day, the site of Shiro Akiko is considered cursed, and no member of the Phoenix Clan will willingly go near it. To this day, the name of Asako Sagoten has become a byword for the dangers of letting one's emotions get the better of them. Emperor Genji insisted that the Last Wish had to be destroyed, but by this point, the Last Wish had grown sentient, as well as gained the ability to read the minds of others, and whenever someone tried to approach it to destroy it, it would simply kill them. Emperor Genji was forced to concede that destroying the Last Wish was too dangerous, and so ordered the Shiba family to hide it, and then he ordered the Isawa family to destroy all notes regarding the Last Wish's creation, to ensure that no one would ever find it or be able to use it. In the 1,000 years following the war with Fu Lang, Emperor Genji's prohibition against using the Last Wish would be violated only once. In the year 234, the latter years of Emperor Genji's reign, a Shugenja named Isawa Hidetsugu managed to discover and steal Isawa's Last Wish for himself. He intended to use it to uncover the secret of the Asako family, which they still refused to share with the Isawa. His attempt resulted in not only his death, but the destruction of Gisei Toshi itself. The Isawa family managed to cook up a convincing cover story to avoid punishment, but were ultimately forced to abandon the site of Gisei Toshi for good. Unfortunately, this was not the end of the Isawa family's woes. Shortly after the end of the war with Fu Lang and the death of Isawa, one of his brothers, Isawa Takeshi, and a group of students decided to continue studying and practicing blood magic in secret, despite the prohibitions of Shinsei. Before, the Seven Great Fortunes had protected the Isawa family, ensuring that their magic remained pure and uncorrupted. But now, the fortunes were extending their protection to all the peoples of Rokugan, and they were spread too thin to ensure that similar protection. Inevitably, Isawa Takeshi became corrupted by the taint, as were his students. Desperate to purge themselves of the corruption, Takeshi's students killed him in a ritual that they thought might save them from the taint. They were wrong. Eventually, they too succumbed to the taint and founded a secret cell of evil magic users, or Maho Tsukai, called the True Sons of Isawa. As for Takeshi, his spirit became a demon, and ever since has returned to the mortal realm, spending all of his days trying to tempt other Shugenja down the same dark path as himself. But it's not all bad for the Isawa. Isawa's original goal was that he and his people could live free from the authority of the Kami. And, to a certain extent, they actually managed to achieve this. All of the great clans of Rokugan are samurai clans, and Shugenja are counted as part of the samurai class. The great clans are comprised of peasants and lesser samurai ultimately ruled over by 3 to 5 primary samurai families, each led by a daimyo. In the case of the other 6 clans, the other daimyos ultimately answer to the clan champion, who is almost always the daimyo of the family descended from its founding kami. The champion of the lion clan is almost always an Okoto. The champion of the crab clan is almost always a Hida. But not the phoenix clan. Yes, the Asako and Shiba families are led by daimyos, and the Shiba daimyo almost always holds the title of Phoenix Clan Champion, but the Isawa family are not ruled by a daimyo, and the Phoenix Clan Champion does not rule the Phoenix Clan. Ultimate authority within the Isawa family and the Phoenix Clan as a whole rests in the 5 Elemental Masters, a council of 5 comprised of the most powerful Shugenja in all of the Phoenix Clan, each the master or mistress of one of the elements. When Shiba asked Isawa to be the Phoenix Clan Thunder, he had knelt before the Shugenja and promised to protect his family. After the war with Fu Leng ended, the Isawa family used this to claim leadership and supremacy over the Phoenix Clan in its entirety. The Shiba family still commanded the actual armies of the clan, but ultimately the Isawa were able to make it so that the Shiba answer to them. To this day, there are some among the Shiba family that resent this, insisting that when Shiba knelt and made his pledge, he had not intended that his descendants should serve the Isawa family in perpetuity. But you try telling that to an Isawa, or imply that perhaps the Isawa might owe something to Shiba and his descendants, considering the sacrifices that the Kami had made on behalf of the entire empire, including the Isawa family, and they suddenly grow offended. But this is a minority opinion. The vast majority of the Shiba family have accepted their role as the military arm of the Phoenix Clan and as the protectors of the Isawa family. But there is still some degree of tension between these two families. And in the eyes of the Shiba family, this is mostly because they see the Isawa as being very disconnected from life in the Phoenix Clan. Being a Shugenja requires years of constant study and meditation, communing with the spirits and the mastery of spells. Whenever an Isawa comes of age, especially if that Isawa is a Shugenja, they are required to spend at least one night in the sacred forest of Isawa Mori, contemplating the universe and their place in it. As such, the Isawa spend so much time focusing on magic that they don't seem to have much time for other affairs. And this extends all the way up to the Council of Elemental Masters, who only communicate with the Shiba family or the clan champion through a person who holds the title Voice of the Elemental Masters. By contrast, when a young member of the Shiba family comes of age, he or she is immediately enrolled in the Phoenix Home Guard, charged with patrolling the lands of the Phoenix Clan and guarding against any outside threat. From the Shiba's point of view, the Isawa could stand to do a little less time studying magic and a little more time spent out among the people they ostensibly rule. Yes, the Asako family also spends a lot of time in isolation, studying and mastering the path of man in secret, but since the Asako also serve as healers and historians for the Phoenix Clan, at least they get out once in a while. That's not to say that the Shiba family are without faults of their own. Given their role as guardians and protectors, The Shiba family are often hailed as among the greatest yojimbo, or bodyguards, in all of Rokugan. If you're an important dignitary from whichever clan you choose, and you want to make sure that you will get where you're going safely, you want to hire a Shiba family bodyguard. Samurai of the Shiba family are incredibly detail-oriented and take the job of ensuring their charge's safety very, very seriously. This makes them very good at their job, but it also means that they are a nightmare for anyone they happen to be visiting. If you happen to be hosting an important personage in Rokugan, and that person happens to have Shiba family bodyguards, then for however long you are hosting this important guest, you are going to have to endure a bunch of samurai in flame-colored armor following you around all day, badgering you about security, constantly pestering you with questions about the number of guards, their watch rotations, their positions, even what they're eating that day. The Shiba family take great pride in this, seeing it as an expression of their attention to detail. Everybody else just thinks this makes them obnoxious and overbearing. Whew, boy, this video is taking longer than I anticipated. Okay, just a few more things left to talk about. Besides being the most magically oriented of the seven great clans, the Phoenix Clan are primarily known for being pacifists, which is weird considering that they're samurai and that this is a world where clans are constantly feuding against one another. But while the Phoenix Clan are realistic enough to recognize that war is sometimes unavoidable, they generally prefer to avoid war when they don't think it's necessary, and would rather exhaust every other option first before going on the warpath. To the Phoenix Clan, all life is precious, and because of this belief, they are often the most likely to stick up for the little guy, particularly the minor clans who are all too often stepped on by their larger and more powerful neighbors. Of course, everybody else interprets the Phoenix Clan's reluctance to fight as either a sign of weakness or cowardice, which means that they are all the more surprised on the rare occasions when the Phoenix do decide to attack in force and use their potent combination of warrior skill and powerful Shugenja magic to literally blow away the competition. And then all the bystanders are shocked at how brutal and thorough the Phoenix are at wiping out their enemies. The Phoenix may be reluctant to play war, but when they do, they play for keeps. Obviously, the Phoenix Clan's propensity for pacifism greatly affects their relations with the other great clans. First, it puts them at odds with both the Lion Clan and the Crab Clan, who, in the eyes of the Phoenix, are far too eager to shed blood when it isn't necessary. As for the Scorpion Clan, the Phoenix neither like nor trust them, but that's not really anything new. Nobody likes the Scorpion Clan. As for the Unicorn Clan, they've been gone from the Empire for so long and have been changed so much by their experiences that they are barely recognizable as samurai. Their Shugenja also practice foreign magics that are weird and unsettling, and so the Phoenix Clan have a hard time trusting them. Unsurprisingly, the Phoenix Clan are on best terms with their two closest neighbors, the Crane Clan to the south and the Dragon Clan to the west. Like the Phoenix, the Crane tend to prefer alternative solutions to violence as a way of solving disputes, so there's plenty of common ground there. But where the pacifism of the Phoenix Clan is entirely a question of principle, with the Crane, non-violent methods are more a question of opportunity. The Crane are political animals first and always. And while the Phoenix Clan are great scholars, knowledge doesn't always translate into political acumen, and they deeply resent all the times that the Crane have taken advantage of them in the scheming of the Imperial Court. As for the Dragon Clan, both they and the Phoenix Clan are very spiritual, perhaps the most spiritual clans in all of Rokugan, and they are the most dedicated to the teachings of Shinsei. What ultimately divides the two clans are their differing attitudes towards these self-same teachings. While the Phoenix study and apply the teachings of Shinsei, the Dragon Clan seem more concerned with trying to interpret and contemplate these teachings. And so they don't really do anything, except sit around on their mountains and meditate all day. As far as the Phoenix Clan are concerned, the Dragon could do better by spending more time on practical applications of knowledge and a little less time sitting around with their heads in the clouds. As their lands are farther north than any of the other great clans, winters in the lands of the Phoenix are harsher than anywhere else, And so the Phoenix Clan have developed the custom of wearing thick outer clothing in the wintertime and developing special shoes that allow them to walk over snow and slippery ice. Thanks to the clan's pacifist policy, the lands of the Phoenix are also the most peaceful in all of Rokugan, with fewer wars fought on Phoenix land than anywhere else. Thanks to the proliferation of Shugenja in Phoenix lands and the dominance of the Asawa family, it's also the most magical part of the Emerald Empire. It is said that when you walk onto the lands of the Phoenix Clan, the very air is suffused with magic, and you are filled with a sense of deep reverence and peace. The people of the Phoenix Clan are closer to the spirits than anyone else, and no matter where you travel on their lands, you are almost always within spitting distance of a temple or monastery. The Phoenix are a clan defined by magic and secrets and sacrifice. Their talent for magic is both their great blessing and their great curse. They're often seen as distant and aloof, uncaring even, but no one understands magic better than they do, and no one is more dedicated to the wisdom of Shinsei than they are. The families of the Phoenix Clan do not get along very well, especially compared to the families of the other great clans, but do not mistake that for disunity. The instant a common enemy threatens them, the Asako, the Shiba, and the Asawa will put aside their petty squabbles and close ranks like a well-oiled machine. And those who dare to provoke them will soon rue the day they did so. For those who incur the wrath of the Phoenix will always, ultimately, burn.